always really good at drawing. I remember I was always doodling in all my textbooks. My math textbooks were like just half drawing, and I would come home from school and I would look up fashion magazines or open up fashion magazines, and I would draw pictures of all the things that I wanted that I couldn't afford at that time, right? And back then, I thought everyone was good at drawing. I thought drawing was like, oh, well, if you have hands, you can draw. It's as simple as that. And so people would tell me, you could be able to sell this, you can make a career out of this. But I just assumed that it was very commonplace to be able to draw, so I didn't see it as something special. So what I want you guys to do is think about, what are the things that come naturally to do to you? What are some of the things that you do while you're procrastinating that just seem to kind of come out of your soul? Because the thing is, the things that come really naturally to you are something that you could probably turn into a career or a business, and then your work wouldn't feel like work. So are you usually the person who connects people and introduces people? Maybe you could do events, right? Or are you somebody who's always online looking at the newest trends? Maybe you could start a fashion store like Jay, right? It's really important to think about, what are the things that you tend to do naturally that you don't have to really think twice of? The next thing that you want to do is think about, what are the things that you don't want to do? And it's really important to have an idea of what you don't want to do, because when you're thinking about your ideal day, you're thinking about the type of business that you want, you don't want to create a business that almost turns into a trap for you, or create a lifestyle where you're doing a whole bunch of stuff that you want to do. And at least if you know that, you know what you can either avoid, or if you turn this into a career or a business, you can end up delegating that to someone. So for me, I'm not a big fan of numbers. Spreadsheets and forms make me fall asleep, so I know that I can delegate that out to an accountant or delegate that out to a bookkeeper, right? It's really good to think of, what are the things that you don't like to do. Some people don't like to do things that are creative or, you know, with design or something like that. So make sure that you have that in mind. And then the next thing that you want to do, and I think that this is the most important part, is think about what makes you kind of warm and tingly inside. What's the last thing that you've done? Maybe you've helped someone, you've made an impact on someone, you've trained someone, you've taught someone something. When's the last time that you sort of felt like those warm, tingly feelings inside? And that's really important to know, because especially if you're gonna start your own business or if you're on your journey to get to your yes, there are gonna be times where it's a little bit tough. There are gonna be times where you have to work a little bit harder. And so if you don't have that internal thing that you're really passionate about that makes you feel warm and fuzzy inside, it's gonna be really easy for you to lose your motivation. A perfect example from my life is, I kind of was an introvert when I first started Yes Supply, very shy, and I would find that if I would go to a party with like 40 people, I always end up in a corner with one person just having the deepest heart-to-heart ever. Like, there could be a whole party going on, like rap music playing, and we would just be in a corner talking about someone's life and their job and their relationships and how they're not seeing their potential and what they could be doing to get better. And I always thought that that was weird about myself, and I always thought that was different about myself. But now that I'm doing Yes Supply and I coach people one-on-one, I realized that that was just training for me to do something that comes naturally to me and to do something that I love to do. So it's a really good idea for you to think about, what is the weird thing that you do? Do you end up in parties having little heart-to-hearts with people, or is there something kind of different that your friends don't necessarily do, or maybe they don't understand why you do it? And that might actually be a key or a hint of what you're meant to be doing. So I want you guys to take that in for a second. I see a lot of nodding heads, so that's amazing. So once you have discovered your yes, maybe during this talk right now you kind of have that aha moment, or maybe you need to go home and take some more time to think about it. But I want to give you a warning. Once you have figured out what your yes is, once you come up with this amazing idea, you feel like you could make millions and impact people all over the world and you're absolutely going to kill it, there's one thing that's going to happen. You're going to get scared out of your mind. Literally every single negative thought that could ever happen is going to rush into your head. You can't do that. You're not smart enough to do that. There's already 500 other people doing that. How are you going to stand out, right? You've never done that before. Why is anyone going to pay you money to do it when she's doing it and she already has 10,000 followers on Instagram, right? And so what you need to do when you've figured out what your yes is and you know that this is what you're meant to do, is you need to take action. You need to take action and you need to not let those voices stop you. Because the second that you stop, all those voices are gonna take over, and that's when you're gonna lose your momentum and you're gonna stay in the exact same place that you were when you began. So progress essentially negates fear. If you have any fear at all, once you start taking action, you'll move through it. Another thing that progress really helps with is narrowing down your focus. So when I first started Yes Supply, I knew I want to empower women. I want to help them live their best life. But the only problem is I'm super creative. Who in this room is really creative person? Anyone? Yeah? Kat? Okay, cool. Couple people. So the issue that creatives have is that we love everything. Like literally, I love everything. So I started off Yes Supply and I was like, okay, I'm going to blog about technology, the coolest apps. I'm going to blog about my favorite movies. I'm going to talk about health. If you go back to the beginning of Yes Supply, there is a blog on the cleanse that my fiance and I did. Like, there is so much random stuff at the beginning of Yes Supply. But I'll tell you something, the fastest way to figure out what it is you want to do is just to take action and narrow it down. Because as soon as I started blogging about a little bit of everything, I realized, okay, I like health, but maybe that's not what I want to do 100%. And I like cool apps, but I get bored of them in 3 days, so maybe I don't need to write an article about them, right? And so the faster you start to take action, you actually narrow down what is the thing that you want to do. And the sooner you put it out there and you start telling people about it, you get to see what kind of brings you back to that warm, fuzzy feeling that makes you feel good about what you're doing about it all. And I know this from experience too, because I actually bought the domain for Yes Supply pretty much a year before I started actually doing anything with it. So I bought the domain and I sat on it and I did a little bit of blogging on my own, but I was too afraid to tell anyone about it. I thought everyone would think it was cheesy, everyone would think I was weird, too positive, and so I kept it to myself and I told myself, if I buy this domain and I don't do anything with it for a year, I'm just gonna let go of it. I'm just gonna give it up, I'm just gonna forget about it. And I remember pretty much 9 or 10 months around, I got that email that came into my inbox, domain expiry warning. And I looked at it, and I could have let it expire, and imagine if I did, right? Like imagine if I did, I would be in the exact same place as when I started, right? And something inside of me was telling me, no, don't let it go. And I listened to it. And so sometimes when you have that little voice inside, even though you're scared and even though you don't know where it's going to go, listen to it because it's trying to tell you what it is that you're meant to do. So now I want to share with you a few tips once you've figured out your yes to help you shift your mindset and break through the current patterns that you have in your life to make sure that you make your yes happen. Because again, that fear, it's not as easy as just taking action. There's going to be a lot of things that come into your life, a lot of things that slow you down. So I want to share with you a few kind of mindset hacks that helped me. So the first thing that you want to do is you want to believe that you can do it. So I know that sounds so cheesy and everyone says, you know, it's cliche, believe in yourself, believe that you can do it. But it's important because when you first start doing something, your friends might not understand it. Your family might not understand it. You know, my first sale for my Good Morning Beautiful emails was somebody in Australia, somebody who had never met me, right? So if not everyone around you gets it at first, don't worry. Just believe that you can do it and believe that eventually, if you keep going, you're gonna make it work. A great way to do this is by positive affirmation. So I say, I talk to myself a lot, just putting that out there. Positive affirmations, even if you don't believe them at first, eventually they help you change your way of thinking. And so where you used to say, I can't do it, I'm not good enough, I don't know it, you start to think, maybe I can do it. Maybe if I don't know it, I can learn it. And the fact is, if there's someone out there who is doing something that you want to do, they are proof that it is possible, right? If you can see somebody, you know, traveling to Bali and being a really cool fashion blogger, or, you know, standing on stage and doing public speaking like you knew that you want to do, just remember that they were born a naked baby, just like you. No one's born knowing how to take a photo. No one's born knowing how to do public speaking. Everyone starts not really knowing what they're doing. So if you can see something in the real world that you want to do, that means that there's proof that you can do it. So all you have to do is believe in yourself and start taking the steps forward until you make it a reality. The next thing that you want to do is just keep a laser focus on exactly what it is that you want to do. So again, like I said, there's going to be people who don't get it, maybe make you want to change your mind. Keep a laser focus on exactly what you want and don't stop. So for me, you know, it would have been really easy for me to get distracted or say, you know, I don't have enough time, I don't have enough resources, I don't know what I'm doing, I've never blogged before, I've never gone to social media following before, I don't know what I'm doing. But what I did was I kept a laser focus on exactly what I wanted to do. And it's easy to look at Yes Supply Now and assume that I had a whole month to work on it, or that I had a whole team of graphic designers working under me. But Yes Supply was made in little 10-minute increments. It was 50 minutes when I was on my commute to my old job, you know, writing, finishing off a blog post, right? Or it was 5 minutes when I was waiting in line for coffee, you know, commenting someone back on Instagram who said that they liked something that I posted. So if a task that you want to work on seems too big, break it down into little chunks. But just make sure that every single day you're taking a step forward and taking that step closer to what you want to do. If you have to take it 10 minutes at a time, that's okay, because at least it's 10 minutes in the right direction. No one said that you have to achieve your dream overnight. No one said that you have to achieve your dream in 3 months. It's okay if it takes a while, but again, it's that term of drifting. Do you want to drift into somewhere you don't want to go, or do you want to slowly but surely get to that island that you want? It's up to you. And if you keep your eyes on that place where you want to go, and you focus on it, and you don't let anything pull you away, you will eventually get there. The next sort of mindset hack that I want to share with you is to change your thoughts. Change your thoughts. So how many people in this room have a lot of thoughts inside their head that say, you know, you can't do it, you know, you're not good enough, she's prettier than you, she's this, she's that. Does anyone, or am I the only one? Yeah, okay, good. So maybe I'm the only one, I'll just leave and you guys can all enjoy your happy thoughts together. So have fun with that. So what I want to share with you is that your thoughts essentially become reality. Whatever you think in your mind, is anyone here into like law of attraction or manifesting? Okay, cool. So some of you guys already know this stuff, your thoughts become reality. But even if you don't believe in the law of attraction or manifesting, I want you to realize that whatever you think about perpetuates into reality, because you are essentially a mirror of your external world. And that sounds kind of crazy, so I'm going to give you a perfect example. So like I said before, a few years ago, I was really shy. You know, I didn't have a lot of confidence. I would never have stood in front of a group of like even like four of you guys, to be honest. And it's because of the thoughts that were in my head. And that's why you have to break the patterns of the thoughts that are going on in your head, you know? We're all born thinking that we can do anything. Remember when we're kids and we think one second we're Wonder Woman, the next moment we're a mermaid, right? And then somehow when we're surrounded by people who have sort of regular thinking habits, we sort of go into those regular thinking habits of a regular life doing what regular people do. But you don't have to think that way. So a few years ago, I was, you know, shy, not confident, and it was hard for me to meet new people. I had my little group of friends and my cousins, and that was essentially it. And I realized now, looking back, it was because of the thoughts that I had in my head. So if I were to ever walk into a room full of a group of people that I didn't know, the thoughts in my head were, you're not that interesting. No one's gonna wanna talk to you. You guys don't have anything in common. They're not gonna wanna be their friends, your friends. And so what do you think I looked like? What do you think I came across as with those thoughts in my head, right? Walking into a room thinking, oh, she's not gonna wanna be my friend. Well, then I probably had a look, like, I probably was mean mugging, right? Like, I probably wasn't looking too friendly. And if I just assumed off the bat, well, no one's gonna be my friend, then definitely I was not gonna start a conversation with someone and risk being rejected, right? So do you see how those thoughts in my head were perpetuating my reality? I was saying, no one's gonna wanna talk to me, no one's gonna wanna be my friend, no one's gonna wanna be interested in Yes Supply, and I was making that my reality. So what I did, and what makes it a lot easier for me to meet new amazing people every day, is now when I walk into a room, I decide, what do I want my reality to be? And I think that, and it becomes real. So now if I walk into a room, and you can use this in your own life too, in any example you want, you walk into the same room and you say, you know what, maybe someone in here has similar interests to me. Maybe someone in here will be my friend. Maybe someone in here will be interesting, or find me interesting. Or maybe instead of waiting for someone to accept me, it's up to me to walk into the room and accept other people, right? How much would that change if instead of going into a room and hoping that someone comes up and talks to you, you just walk into a room and be the friendliest person there, right? And so think about different experiences in your life and situations in your life where you're telling yourself, I can't do that. Is it that meeting at work where everyone's talking and you feel afraid to raise your hand and say your opinion because you don't think anyone's gonna think your opinion is important? What if that thought process in your head said, maybe someone will think that my point of view is interesting. I don't usually speak up, so maybe they need a feminine perspective. Women are always right anyway. George knows that.
I hear that once a day.
Yeah, so think about how your thoughts are perpetuating your reality, and remember that your inner world is legitimately a mirror of your outer world. The next mindset shift that I want to share with you, a great way to break your current patterns, is to be very mindful of the language that you use. So I have one friend in particular, she's not here tonight, and she uses the word, I'm poor, a lot. Oh, I can't quit my job at this place that I hate because then I'll be poor. Oh, I just bought that Balenciaga bag, so now I'm poor. And do you realize how if you're constantly telling yourself that you're poor, your mind and your subconscious is going to continue to keep you in that place where you're poor, and that works out for every single little thing, right? So in terms of language, this is a really, 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 really cool thing. So has anyone heard of the water experiment by the Japanese scientist? Yeah, okay, cool. So there's this Japanese scientist called Emoto, and he did this water experiment that's really, really cool. So essentially they take two samples of water, and to one sample of water they say negative words. So they say, you know, you're stupid, I hate you, you're dumb, you know, anything negative that you could say, they say it to that one vial of water. Then to another vial of water, they say, you're beautiful, I love you, I'm grateful for you, you're fantastic. They say all kind, loving words. Those probably aren't the exact same words, but you get the drift, right? And the really interesting thing was they would take those two vials of water and they would crystallize it, so they essentially would freeze it, and they would look at it under a microscope. And the vial of water that had been said negative words to it, when they looked at the shapes that it would crystallize into, it was shapeless. It was weird, asymmetrical shapes. The color was very dull. It was just sort of a blob of ice, essentially. And that's the most eloquent way I can say it. And then they would look at the water that they had crystallized after saying kind words to it. So I love you, you're beautiful, you're amazing. And when they would look at the water, it was in the shape of beautiful snowflakes. So snowflakes like on Christmas morning. And isn't that interesting how thoughts and words, something that doesn't take up any space. I'm talking to you right now, but my words don't take up any space. We could all be talking to each other and it doesn't feel like our words are matter. But isn't it interesting that those words change something in the physical world? I know my friend Maria knows when you talk to plants, they grow a lot faster. And I talk to my plants too, and I used to kill lots of plants, and now I have a few, although I've killed a few cactuses, guys, yeah. So I'm not embarrassed about that. Yeah. In my past, that was my dark past. So what I'm trying to say to you is that things that you say change the physical world, and I want you to remember that your body is made up of 70% water. So think about that. When's the last time you messed something up at work and you said, oh, you're so dumb, right? Or like, oh, you look in the mirror and you wake up in the morning, like, oh, I hate my hair, I hate my clothes, I don't have enough clothes to wear, I need to go shopping at JS Store, right? Like, these words, you might think that they don't have any effect on you, but if it has that type of effect on water and your body is 70% water, you need to think about the language that you're using on yourself every day and think about what could happen if you change the things you were saying to yourself to be kinder, to be loving. Would it hurt you to say, you know what, I kind of like my eyes, instead of saying, oh, I hate this giant zit on my face, right? Like, would it be that hard to change the way that you're looking at yourself and talking to yourself? And think about how much your potential would change if you instead said, maybe I can try that and see what happens if I go after my yes, instead of saying, oh, I could never do that, I've never done it before. Right? And the third thing that I want to share with you in order to break your current patterns is to change the way that you look at yourself. So this was something that I had to really work on and really struggle with when I was going from seeing myself as a typical, you know, 9-to-5 job girl to somebody who was supposed to inspire and lead and say what I thought and speak without being spoken to. And I see this a lot with the women that I work with one-on-one. You know, they want to build a blog or they want to build an online business, right? And so in order to do that, you have to start putting your message out there. And so many of the times they'll come back to me and they'll say, well, who am I to write a blog post and put my ideas out into the world? Who am I to inspire people or share my story, right? And the thing is, and George and I were reading a really interesting book the other day, if you don't look at yourself the way that you need to, or you don't see yourself as somebody who is maybe running that business that you want to run or doing that thing that you want to run, it doesn't matter how many positive movies you watch or how many motivational books you read. If you can't change the way that you see yourself, nothing will change. So it's really important to think about, who do I need to be in order to get to where I need to go, and work on changing those little traits about yourself. And the thing is, I'm not trying to tell you to be someone who you're not, because if you look at someone and you say, oh my God, she's so confident, I wish I could be more like her, or she's so kind and great at making relationships, I wish I could be like her. The fact that you have that desire inside you, or anytime you're experiencing jealousy, that's actually not a negative thing. So essentially, if you are experiencing a want or a desire to be a bigger version of yourself or a bolder version of yourself, that is essentially your creative expression within you. So a idea of what you're supposed to be, that's your creative expression trying to manifest it itself into reality. And if you're resisting that, that's why you feel that pain. That's when you feel that strain. That's when you feel that, oh, I wish I could get that, or I wish I could have that. So listen to that. And so, for example, if you want to write a book, or you want to be a public speaker, or you want to own a shop, think about, what type of person does that? Is she bold? Is she confident? Is she friendly? Is she caring? Is she does she speak without being spoken to? You know, is she outgoing? Whatever it is, write down what those traits are that you wish that you had a little bit more of. And I can say that from experience too, because I used to be shy. I used to find it hard to make new relationships. And so I actually wrote down, what are the things that I feel like I need to be to become the person that I want to be, to do the things that I want to do, to travel to the places or meet the people that I want to see? And I wrote all those things down. And what I did was I just tried to incorporate little bits of it into my everyday until it became easier for me to be that person. So if I knew that I had to be a little bit more bold to be the type of girl who runs a company like Yes Supply, then I decided, okay, I'm gonna do one thing today that's a little bit more bold than what I'm usually used to. Or if I knew that I had to be more outgoing, I'd be like, okay, I'm gonna introduce myself to one person today, even if it's just the guy who serves me coffee every day, right? And what you'll find is, when you stretch outside of your comfort zone, you open up your world to a whole bunch more opportunities, and you'll start to see some amazing opportunities come to you. Does anyone have any questions or anything so far? No? Okay, cool. So before I end off today, I wanna just leave you with a few pillars of becoming essentially a Yes Supply girl or guy. So essentially, if you're going after your yes, you are supplying your own yes. You're figuring out what it is that you want, and then you're going after it with everything inside you. And so one really important pillar, and this is something that I share with my clients and the girls in my community all the time, is to make sure that you create over consume. So if you're spending, you know, an hour on Instagram every day or an hour on Facebook every day, think about that for a second. It might just seem like a couple hours, but if you were to do the math of just on social media or sort of not using your time productively, if it was just 2 hours a day for a whole year, that ends up being a whole month of time. That's 740 hours. Imagine what you could do with 740 extra hours to work on something that you're really passionate about, or work on becoming the person that you want to be. So create over consume. When you're first starting out on your path to your yes, there's going to be a lot of information out there, a lot of articles to read, a lot of books. And it is important to educate yourself, definitely. But you also have to take a step, and you have to do things to get closer and not be afraid of failure and not be afraid of making mistakes. Just like how I wrote a whole bunch of articles that are completely irrelevant on Yes Supply. Because sometimes when you just take that step forward and take action, it's the fastest way to figure out what's gonna work and what's not gonna work. And once you start taking action, you're going to see what is bringing you closer to your purpose and what makes you happy. You're not going to get any further if you're just taking in all the information. And if you don't use the information, eventually you're going to forget it. So don't let the analysis paralysis of reading every single thing that's out there get to you. Make sure that you're also taking it and putting it into action. The next thing that I want to share with you is make sure that you give yourself time for creativity. So who here has like the best thoughts when they're either walking down the street and their phone's dead or they're in the shower? Am I the only one? Yeah. So there's a sort of a there's like a scientific reason for that. So essentially, when you are distracted and you have a whole bunch of things going on, even if you think you're going to get inspired by looking at someone else's blog or, you know, going on Instagram, when you have a whole bunch of things going on, it doesn't give you the opportunity to actually be creative. So when you're creative, it's because your mind that does the most work is kind of working on autopilot, right? So I find that I'm the most creative if I'm in the shower, if I'm going for a walk and my phone is dead, or maybe I'm tidying up kind of mindlessly. That's when all of a sudden I have those aha moments. So give yourself time for creativity, because that happens when your brain is sort of working on autopilot and you're relaxed, and that lets dopamine get released into your brain. And also where your creative thoughts come from is from your unconscious or your subconscious mind. That's what's actually making those associations for you that help you take a few interesting things that you learned that seem completely random and bring them together to kind of give you that, oh, that's kind of a good idea. So give yourself time to be creative and you might actually come up with that awesome idea that becomes your yes. If you're still kind of thinking about, you know, what's that big problem I can solve? How can I impact in the world? What can I do? Think about the things that you complain about the most. So what are the biggest problems that you have? I remember being out, like waiting in line for work when I used to work at a 9-to-5 and waiting in line for coffee and just wishing, oh, I just wish there was a way that I could just come in and grab my coffee. And that's an app, that's ritual, right? You know, think of all the different problems that you experience in your life that you're complaining about and think about maybe there can be a solution, and maybe I'm the one who can come up with the solution for that. Have you ever, you know, commuted to work and had a banana in your bag, and by the time you get to work, it's like a sandwich, like it's flat? Someone was smart enough to invent a little plastic cover to go on the banana. It probably costs 2 cents to manufacture, and that person is probably a billionaire, right? It's like the simplest things, but give yourself time to just think about what are the problems that I'd like to solve, and maybe you can actually make an impact with your interesting way of looking at something. What I also want you guys to do is take some time to visualize. Visualizing, like I said, whatever you can think you can create in the real world, and visualizing and meditating is a great way to just take some calm away from your busy everyday life. Close your eyes and feel and start to experience the things that you already want before you've created them. So I remember before I was even working full time on Yes Supply and doing what I want to do, I had already written out what my ideal day was going to look like, how I was going to wake up and do my meditations and go to yoga halfway through the day. And now I get to live my ideal life, and I kind of saw it in my mind before I created it. So just having that picture in your mind of what you want, you can make that a reality. I remember I also visualized going to Bali, and now I'm running a retreat with one of my friends in Bali. And so just because something kind of seems a little bit far-fetched and kind of doesn't seem like you know how you can do it, all you have to think about is the what. All you have to think about is what you want to create. And if you keep your mind focused on that long enough and you start to get yourself in gear to work towards it, it will all come into place for you. And the most important thing, I think, is to make sure that you're turning it into habits. So again, success or creating the thing that you want is not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen from reading a book and taking a couple actions and then just hoping it falls into place. And the easiest way to make it happen is just to take the things that you know that you need to do and form them into habits. Just like I said, I was working on Yes Supply 10 minutes here, 10 minutes there, 20 minutes there. I made it a habit to take my spare time and instead of, you know, just watching Netflix all night, work towards the thing that I want. So what are that little habits that you can incorporate into your day so that it becomes almost second nature to work towards a life that you want? So I want to leave you with this. If you're in this room right now, you are here for a reason. Literally nothing happens by mistake. And so if there's something in you right now that has been bugging you for a while, that idea that's been following you around for a while, I was there too. I had this crazy idea in my head that I didn't think anyone would understand, that I didn't tell any of my friends about because I was so, thought it was so weird. And now I have people telling me that it's changing their life. I have people that have gone from going from having a crazy idea to starting a business or doing what they think is their purpose because I was brave enough to be myself, even when it was scary. So if you're here right now, I want to encourage you to be brave enough to be your truest self, even if it's different from everyone else around you. And whatever excuse you have, that you don't have the time, neither did I, you don't have the money. I grew up in a single parent household. My mom had to fight my dad for $150 a month child support. So don't think that, you know, someone paid all this money. I got my own way through college. I worked in retail, getting my first condo, you know what I mean? Didn't have the money, didn't have the resources, didn't have amazing connections. You know what? All I had was a vision, and all I had was an idea of the type of life that I wanted to create. And I knew that I only had one life here, so why spend it doing the same thing every day that didn't make me happy and didn't fulfill me? I'm not crying right now, my voice is cracking. So essentially, if you're here right now, I really encourage you to figure out exactly what it is you want, get a laser focus on it, visualize it. Start asking for it every single day and only take yes for an answer. Thank you.
So what do you find, like, actually two questions. What do you like the most about what you do? What do you find are your biggest challenges and weaknesses?
Those are great questions. So what I like the most about what I do is I love my community. I think that's actually a big reason why Yes Supply grew so fast, because it wasn't, like, when I started, it was just a blog, right? It wasn't about making a whole bunch of money. It wasn't about anything like that. It was about the people that I wanted to help. So when I came up with the idea for Yes Supply, it was actually when I was, like, back working in retail, and I was surrounded by really cool people and friends that I just knew were creative, knew were capable of achieving so much with their lives, and wanted, you know, to be an artist or to be an entrepreneur or to be this. And I asked, you know, why don't you do it? Why don't you go after it? And they'd be like, well, I could never do it. I don't have this. I don't have the connections. I don't have the money. And so that's what actually inspired me to start interviewing female entrepreneurs, which is how I started. Because I was like, I wonder what's the difference between people who create their, like, dream life and don't. And honestly, the main difference was those women who I interviewed who had started incredible businesses that were successful and doing exactly what they want. There was no difference, except every time they got a no, they figured out a yes. Every time they hit a wall, they just pivoted and went in another direction. So my favorite part is talking to my one-on-one clients on the phone, helping them make a game plan to create their blog or create their business or grow their following, or even just figure out their purpose if they're like, I want to be doing something more, but I have no idea what I want to be doing. That's my favorite part. So I have the one-on-one clients, and then I also have a community, the Yes Supply Collective too, of girls that I've sort of mentor online in a way too. So that's fun, like seeing their wins and seeing them break through their fears and be like, I finally emailed that client that I wanted to and I got the job, right? Because so many of the time we think that there's all these things that are stopping us, and then we go for it and we're like, oh, I was the only one who was stopping me, right? I've been there. And my biggest struggle, I'm trying to think. I really like everything I do. I guess sometimes it's time management. I think time management is something that a lot of people deal with. So just making sure that I'm still getting my own work-life balance. I'm really passionate about what I do, so sometimes I just want to work from the time I wake up to the time I go to bed, but it's important to, like, find that balance and remember. And sometimes I have to kind of, like, take a step outside of myself, because, like, I'm always focused on helping everyone else, but sometimes I have to, like, kind of, like, act like the girl over there looking at Reese and be like, okay, but if I was coaching Reese, I would probably tell her to chill a bit. So that's probably my biggest struggle, just kind of making sure that I'm managing my time okay and also being like a human.
Yeah.
Kat?
So what makes you feel the most uncomfortable, and how do you overcome that feeling?
So what makes me feel the most uncomfortable? I think that I've kind of trained myself to, so okay, this is actually kind of a good tip. So if you're ever fearful or you're ever scared about something, I learned something, that fear is essentially excitement without breath, right? So coming in today, as soon as I got out of the car, I got scared for a second, and then I realized whatever, you guys are all cool. Like, you're not going to laugh at me, I hope, or at least do it when you leave. So I guess I am always trying to be positive. And I think that the thing that if there was a struggle for me or be uncomfortable is doing too much of the same thing. So if I hadn't taken the leap and quit my job where I just kind of stayed doing the same thing, I think I'm always switching it up, and I'm somebody who likes change and embraces doing different things. So I try and look at fear as an opportunity to try something new. And I think that when you look at it that way and you realize, like, okay, at the end of the day, you know, you're probably not going to go hungry. At the end of the day, you know, you're going to be fine. So, like, why not just do the things that you want to do? Sorry, that probably doesn't answer it.
You essentially said comfort makes you feel uncomfortable.
Yeah, it's true.
It's very cool.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I remember, like, being in school and wanting to do things and, like, apply for a job and thinking, oh, I'm too young. I don't have enough experience. And then now, like, also hitting an age where I'm like, oh, my gosh, am I too old for this now? Did I miss my mark? Like, what's your experience with coaching women or, like, talking to women who have that struggle with, like, the number of their age and, like, yeah.
You know what? It's so funny you said that, because I was actually just thinking about that the other day, right? When you're like, oh, I'm too young and no one's going to take me seriously. I'm like, oh, I'm too old and I'm not cool anymore. And or whatever. And, or yeah, anyway, I'm not saying old people aren't cool. Everyone's cool. Have you seen that? What's her name? Oh, shoot, what's her name? That really cool old lady with the big glasses?
Iris.
Yeah, she's so badass. Anyway, what I would say is there's no rules. One thing that I've realized is that there's literally no rule. There's no rule that you're too young to do something. Shopify, I know you use Shopify. Shopify has these really cool, like, kidpreneurs. There's this little, like, black kid who makes these ties. Have you seen, or bow ties? Mm-hmm. That's so cute, right? And it's like, he's probably like 13 making bow ties or whatever. And then, you know, there's old people who live their whole life and they're like, you know, I'm sick of being retired. I'm gonna go. And there's that old lady who does, like, gymnastics or, like, runs marathons. So I would say that if you are thinking that there's this rule of doing something because you're too old or doing something because you're too young, I think you're imposing that on yourself. And don't worry, like, I'm turning 28 next week and I'm like, damn it, I want to make the Forbes 30 under 30 and I probably won't, but it's like, it's
just, you got 2 years.
Just like, 2 years, let's see if I can make it happen. Forbes, if you're watching. No, I'm kidding. But it's like, do you know what it is that you want to do?
Sometimes.
What is it?
I don't know. I don't want to say.
Okay.
I don't know.
It's a good first step to say
like
it.
Like past lives, and I feel like I've like redone a lot of things.
Yeah.
Like still thinking.
Yeah. Well, I started off, you know, being a fashion stylist, and that was actually kind of. It's so funny because, like, back then I thought I was a failed fashion stylist, but now doing what I do, I realize that if I didn't fail back then at doing that, I wouldn't have come with the idea for Guest Supply, because back then I was struggling to, like, be an entrepreneur, and there was no good resources. So that was the problem that I was solving Guest Supplies. Like, there's no good resource for female entrepreneurs. Let me try and make some, right? Let me try and interview people and ask all the questions that no one else is asking. Like, I'm not going to take, oh, I just fell into this job. Like, it was so easy. Like, I was sick of reading interviews like that. So essentially, honestly, remember that there is no rules. Like, if you're saying I'm too old or too young, it's like, is there an age group? Like, I bet there's not, right? So just don't put too much pressure on yourself and don't impose too many rules, or don't say, well, I'm too old to be a fashion blogger because that fashion blogger is 16. You don't have to compare yourself to someone. In fact, the things that make you unique are actually the things that are going to make you stand out. If you want to go into something and you think, oh, there's too much competition, I'm never going to succeed, that's not true. It's like, just find the thing that is so you about you and use that to your advantage to stick out. Like, imagine Jaya was like, oh, well, H&M and Zara already exist, so I guess, like, yeah, I'm just not going to start a store. But it's like, look how freaking cool this store is, right? And, like, look how amazing her clothes is. Like, you're not going to find that crop top at Zara. Like, awesome. So whatever it is that's unique about you, maybe you're the oldest person who's doing it, that's okay. Use it to your advantage and try and find your unique angle on it.
Yes. Do you come across women who are quite successful, like, in their career, 9-5?
Yes.
And also want to be entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. So how do you guide them, and when do they cut the cord? Because it could be quite, you know, they're building a career on the 9-to-5, so they're, you know, in boards and panels and doing what they feel they need to do. Like,
yeah. their company, and they also want to do their own thing on the side. So
yeah.
even though they manage, because I always feel sometimes entrepreneur, a lot of people I talk to say, oh, I quit my job so I can start this. But it's always that little segment of people who love what they do, but also want to do something for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So at what point do they get to where, like, not exhaust yourself, but when do they just cut the cord and decide to go on their own? Or what advice would you say?
Yeah, so I would say that if you are working a 9-to-5 job and you're finding it completely fulfilling, there's nothing wrong with
yeah.
working a 9-to-5 job. There's nothing wrong with, you know, working for someone else if you feel like you're doing what you meant to do and you're happy and you enjoy your team and you enjoy your pay and you feel like you're able to be yourself. There's nothing wrong with that.